Good morning. We begin with breaking news out of Canberra. Straight to reporter Fiona Whelan-Fee. There's been a development over the deportation of a Queensland family.
Mark, so we've just learned a moment ago that the family can remain in Australia until at least September 4. Now, the matter has been heard by the federal court this morning, and we are told they've been granted a temporary injunction until the next hearing. Overnight, the Tamil couple and their two Australian-born daughters narrowly avoided being deported to Sri Lanka. They were taken from immigration detention in Melbourne and forced onto a charter plane. That was on its way to Sri Lanka when a federal court judge granted an injunction over the phone, preventing the government from sending them back. However, that injunction was due to expire at midday. The plane landed in Darwin instead, and that is where they are today. The Home Affairs Minister says that this case has already been reviewed by a Magistrates Court, the Federal Court and the High Court, and dismissed.
I would like the family to accept that they are not refugees, that they're not owed protection by our country. They came here by boat and we've been very clear that they wouldn't stay.
Is this what we have come to? A government taking two children who were born in this country, ripping a family out of a community in Bilawila, a community that wants them there, and deporting them at a time when there is a genuine and serious question about the safety of Tamils being returned to Sri Lanka.
Now, the family had been living in Bilawila in Queensland before their bridging visas expired last year. The local community had been pushing for them to stay, and Labor is now calling for the Prime Minister to intervene. Mark.
Fiona Whelan with the very latest from Canberra. Thank you. Well, Sydney is being swamped, the city and surrounds hammered by heavy rain. More than 60 millimetres has fallen in 24 hours, with downpour set to deliver a month's worth of rain across 2 days. The deluge is causing havoc on busy roads. Drivers being warned today to take care in the hazardous conditions. Thunderstorms will rattle coastal areas of the harbour city, while other parts of the state have woken to what looks like a dusting of snow, hail blanketing the ground in Coffs Harbour. The rain band is slowly moving north, but citysiders should brace for a wet weekend. Now to a big story in Melbourne, where a young apprentice jockey has died after a fall at Cranbourne Racecourse. The 22-year-old woman was on a routine trackwork ride when she fell around 4:30 this morning. A race meeting scheduled today at Pakenham has been abandoned out of respect to the rider and her family. Notorious triple killer Berwyn Rees has been released from prison after almost 40 years behind bars. Nine's Kelly Fedor was at Sydney's Silverwater Jail this morning as the murderer walked free.
Berwyn Rees walked out of Silverwater Prison clutching his possessions in a plastic bag. Now aged 70 and heavily overweight, he struggled to get into the van which was waiting for him. As he was driven past the many cameras watching, he had his arms folded and appeared to smirk. Berwyn, anything you want to say? He served almost 39 years behind bars for murdering gun shop owner Ray James and his customer Christopher Greenfield in a Bondi Junction gun store in 1977. He was on the run in 1980 when he shot and killed Sergeant Keith Hayden. He will be the most heavily watched parolee in the state given a terrorist classification. That includes 24-hour-a-day monitoring. He will also have to tell his parole officer what he plans to do for the entire week. The state government had fought this release. His victims' families are also extremely disappointed. They believe he still poses a very significant risk.
But all there. Well, a terrifying ride for passengers on a regional flight from Sydney to Merimbula, one of the plane's engines catching fire mid-air. Tiff Genders has more.
The Rex flight took off from Sydney Airport last night on a two-leg journey scheduled to stop in Moruya and then on to Merimbula. The first trip was without incident, but shortly into the second leg, passengers and cabin crew reported seeing sparks or flames coming from the right side engine. One woman described it as the most terrifying experience of her life. The quick-thinking captain managed to shut down the engine and activate the fire suppression system. Firefighters, paramedics and police got word there'd be an emergency landing and they were waiting for the aircraft as it came down.
It had flames or sparks that were seen from the engine. The crew shut the engine down. Once everybody was evacuated safely, we went over to the aircraft. and made sure that there was no further danger.
Aviation experts say engine failure is rare, but planes can fly with only one in operation. Initial investigations suggest there was no fire, but a mechanical fault which could have caused those sparks. Rex has notified safety regulators and has engineers on the scene in Marimbula to inspect the plane.
Police are working to track down a speeding driver who left a woman to die in a hit run in Melbourne. Mark Santo Martino has the latest on the search.
A woman we understand to be a university student was crossing at these lights along Wellington Road just outside of Monash University's Clayton campus last night when she was hit by a driver at speed. Her body was thrown at least 20 metres from the pedestrian crossing, and unfortunately she died here at the scene of her injuries.
I saw the car hit the woman, yeah, and it was crazy, you know.
Police have not confirmed whether or not she was crossing with a green light, but what is clear is that the dark sedan that struck her did not stop at the scene. Witnesses have said it continued west before being dumped in the driveway of an old church some 700 metres away. That car has since been towed. Police say the vehicle has not been reported stolen, so there's a good chance the authorities know who they're looking for. In the meantime, anyone with dash cam footage that can help is being called to come forward and help identify this driver.
Now to East Timor, which is preparing to mark 20 years of independence. Lizzie Pearl is there.
Well, it's been almost 12 years since an Australian Prime Minister visited Timor-Leste, and today Scott Morrison flies in for what will be a day of great historical significance, but also it's not without controversy. Today, August 30, marks 20 years since the people of East Timor went to the polls in a United Nations-backed ballot and won their independence from Indonesia, which had occupied the country for 24 years. There's a real vibe about the capital, Dili. There are flags about, and there is a real buzz around the city as people mark this historic day. Today is also the day that both nations have chosen to make official a new maritime border agreement, which basically redraws the sea boundaries between Australia and Timor-Leste, and also sets up new rules for the sharing of oil and gas resources in the Timor Sea. It gives the Timorese a far greater share in a move which is largely being seen as righting an historical wrong. The Prime Minister flies in to what is a day being overshadowed by a spy scandal. There is a lot of pressure to drop the charges against a man, a former spy known only as Witness K, and his lawyer, who were accused of revealing Australian secrets, namely that Australia bugged the cabinet offices of the Timor-Leste government in 2004 to get an upper hand in negotiations over that sea border. Lots on the agenda today, a very busy day today for Prime Minister Scott Morrison. He will be joined by Foreign Minister Maurice Payne and also the opposition leader Anthony Albanese in Dili as the country celebrates well into the night.
Hi YouTubers, I'm Davina Smith. Well, click here to keep watching Great Nine videos and subscribe to our channel here for lots more news, analysis and exclusive content. For breaking news, see you at 9news.com.au.